And thank you to all the speakers before me. I learned a lot today. I do want to try to keep it. I feel that, you know, this is Friday, 5 p.m. I'm all that stands between happy hour and the weekend, right? So I'm going to keep it short and hopefully useful to you. So today I'm going to talk about vertical AI is a new horizontal. So we heard a lot about Gen AI with the Cambrian explosion of generative AI and with Mindanai AI being relatively new to the market. I always get asked these questions by job candidates. How is Mindanai AI differentiated as an AI company? Why should I join? It turns out that investors are also asking a similar question. They believe that AI is going to generate a lot of value, and as investors, they are trying to find out where would value accrue the most. Andreessen Horowitz, one of the most respected VCs in the Valley, wrote an article, "Who Owns the Generative AI Platform?" a couple of months ago. And in that article, they argued that there will be both horizontal and vertical winners in generative AI. Even though this article is about generative AI, I think it applies more broadly to AI in general. And at Mindanai AI, we have somewhat an opinionated view of this vertical versus horizontal divide. It's because we believe the best native AI product and experiences are built end-to-end. Which leads to the next question. What is a vertical AI startup? So many speakers talk about using ChatGPT to do their talk today. I actually really tried. Right, so I asked ChatGPT, and yeah, but ChatGPT couldn't give me a good answer. ChatGPT says that there's no agreed upon definition of what is a vertical AI startup. And when I did a quick check on the internet, it's actually true. I couldn't find, there were many definitions that didn't quite capture how we think about vertical AI startups at Mindanai AI. Fortunately, I found one that is close enough, and that is from Bradford Cross. He talked about it in 2017 in a series of videos and articles. So for Bradford, there are four factors that define a vertical AI startup. A full-stack product, proprietary information, AI delivering core value, and then subject matter expertise. Of these four, I think that three of the first three define what is a vertical AI startup. And let's deep dive into them. Full stack product means that you provide a full stack end-to-end product to solve your customer problems. That includes having the interface that serves the customer needs, all the way down to the functionality and having the homegrown model that powers this interface. This ecosystem is more defensible than having proprietary information or models. It takes subject matter expertise to design the interface. Once you design the interface, you can instrument it to collect proprietary insights that you can use to train your AI model, AI ML models that power or drive high-value functionality. And you create this virtuous cycle between the interface and your insights. You have access over this information value chain, and you can build defensibility over time. An example of this is this company called Blue River. They are agriculture company, they manufacture agriculture equipment that saves chemicals and reduce costs. They essentially personalize the treatment for each plant by spraying a herbicide on the weeds, but not the crop or the soil. They use computer vision to identify the type of plant, then use machine learning to decide the type of treatment, and then robotics to execute the precise action for each plant. Blue River is incredibly defensible because it's very hard to build such a complex end-to-end product. From gathering the training set for your models, to incorporating your models and the robotics on equipment, to fixing the to having the equipment fixed onto the farm machinery, and then building the distribution channels for this. Blue River was acquired by John Deere a couple of years ago for more than $300 million. Next, proprietary insights. The tech space is incredibly competitive. When you have something that works, people are going to copy you. Right? You see that even in the early days of Gen AI, you see that very much now. Right? There are apps that pop up every day that disappear after a few months. And just now, Sao Xiong was talking about pets.com and stuff like that. Defensible AI businesses built on proprietary insights are difficult to replicate. And you do that in two phases, bootstrapping and then compounding. In the bootstrap phase, you generate your unique training set by using, say, publicly available information and then enriching it through some complex interactions. Or you generate your data through simulations. Once you're bootstrapped, you have this information flywheel. You're collecting unique insights about how your product is being used. They are designed to serve the needs of your models. And your models are designed to serve the needs of your product functionality, which are designed to serve the needs of your consumer or your customer. This information value chain aligns the motivation of the customer with yours in order to compound the value of this proprietary information. Examples of these companies are the self-driving car companies like Waymo, Tesla, and Envira.ai, which uses AI to do breast cancer screening to reduce the cost, increase the accuracy, and reduce the time. Essentially, the harder it is to gather your training set, the more intertwined it is with your product and your go-to-market strategy, the more defensible your AI business is. Third, AI delivering core value. This is where I have a slightly different, I think I have a slightly more relaxed definition of this than Cross. Cross concedes that the big tech companies like Amazon, Netflix, Facebook, all use AI to drive a very high lift in their revenue, their profitability, and their engagement. But he doesn't think of them as vertical AI companies, because he feels that they are optimizing existing opportunities and not unlocking new opportunities. To Cross, Amazon is an e-commerce company, Netflix is a media company, and Facebook is a social media company. Right? He says that in these companies, AI is like a sidecar, AI sidecar. Right? It makes me think about the sidecar pattern in microservices. For Cross, examples of companies that unlock new opportunities with AI are the lending companies that use AI to decide whether to give you a loan and to price the interest rates of the loans using dynamic information. For me, as long as AI is driving a huge or significant lift in your revenue and your profitability, it doesn't matter as much whether it's unlocking new opportunities or optimizing existing opportunities. To me, both of them are vertical AI companies. The more the AI delivers the core value of a product through unlocking new opportunities or optimizing existing opportunities, through rich domain modeling within a particular vertical, based on the models built on the proprietary insights that you collect through your product, the more defensible your business is. So let's try to apply Cross's three factors to Mindanai AI. Right. Firstly, to many people out there, to the uninitiated, we launch You, right? And You is just a loyalty program where you earn and burn points. But it's more than that. We're solving the bigger and more exciting problem of promotion hyper-personalization, particularly for brick-and-mortar retail. Most of us, who have shopped at who have gone into a physical stores, know that the promotions are mass and inefficient, and there's no even way of knowing which promotions they are until you walk into the store. We first kickstart the flywheel by working with like-minded partners like DBS, Cold Storage, Giant, BreadTalk Group, Singtel, and Mandai to launch U Rewards Club, where we provide value to the consumers in terms of points and also very relevant and exciting promotions. This drives consumers to continue shopping or to make purchases at our partners. This completes the first inner flywheel. Through the transactions that consumers make at the partners, we know whether the promotions are relevant. We know whether the promotions are useful in shaping consumers' shopping preferences. This helps us build better personalization models for the consumers, which in turn drives more value back to the consumers and to the partners. This completes the second outer flywheel. Now, you can see all three aspects of Bradford's across three factors here. First, full stack product. We have U Rewards Club, whereby we have the U app where consumers interface with. And then we have the homegrown models that power our hyper personalization. Second, the proprietary insights. Through the construct of our flywheel, we get very valuable feedback of whether our promotion models or hyper-personalization AIML models are working for the consumer. And thirdly, AI delivers the core value of promotion hyper-personalization for Mindanai AI. So at this stage, you might be wondering, why am I talking about a vertical AI startup in a conference about engineering effectiveness? It turns out that engineering effectiveness is actually very relevant for a vertical AI startup if you believe what Peter Novick says. AI is like raisins and raisin bread. Most of the bread or most of the AI software is actually good software engineering and product development. At Mindanai AI, we believe that good software engineering is just as important as good AI. We almost have engineering effectiveness baked into our culture in our inception because we launched Big Bang. Right, you heard a lot about experimental, you heard a lot about, we didn't do that. Right? No alpha, no beta, we just launched. That's a story for another time. Right? We now have, on a regular basis, more than 1 million consumers earning and burning points with us every month. Without engineering effectiveness, we wouldn't have launched a working product. Without a working product, there's no way we'd have kickstarted the flywheel. Secondly, on the right, you see Andrew Ng's virtuous AI cycle. Many people try to follow this, but what one thing that this cycle tells us is that machine learning or AIML development is actually very iterative and experimental in nature. A priori, there's no way to know which functionality, which interface, which model is going to work. And so AIML, by default, is very experimental, very iterative. And engineering effectiveness allows us to go through, to have more of these cycles safely, because right now, we have more than 1 million consumers interacting with our product every month. And with that, I come to the end of my talk. Key takeaways, vertical AI companies are defensible and valuable. Three factors, full stack product, proprietary insights, AI delivers core value. And last one, AI is like raisins on a raisin bread. To end it off, Xiao Xiong talked about pets.com. He talks about delivering value. It's very easy to get caught up in this AI hype at building stuff. Right? I think that was what Xiao Xiong is trying to emphasize. And this is actually not the first AI hype cycle. For some of us, this is the second time. Right? The first one was between 2013 to 2018.
Back then, it was known as big data, it was known as machine learning, it was known as many different things. I hope that this framework will allow you to think about where do you invest your energy in AI? Right? When do you build, when do you buy, and how do you create a competitive advantage, a defensible business in your job setting? Thank you very much.